Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor for Radiology, and I'm here today with Dr. Mauricio Castillo, who's the Professor of Radiology and Chief of the Division of Neuroradiology at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And Dr. Castillo wrote for us a really, really beautiful review entitled History and Evolution of Brain Tumor Imaging, Insights Through Radiology, that we'll be publishing in our special issue of Radiology entitled Exploring the Evolution of Imaging. So Dr. Castillo, Mauricio, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks, Debbie. Thanks for inviting me, and thanks for inviting me to write that article.
This has been a lot of fun for me to put together and to interact with so many experts in their respective fields, but I know it was a lot of work to review the literature, not only in radiology, but in other publications as well. When you went through this, were there any unexpected, interesting findings for you?
Well, Debbie, it was also a lot of fun for me, but it was also a lot of work, as you said. One of the most fun things for me in this revision was to see how neuroradiology has evolved from the standpoint of brain tumor imaging. And I think that it tells not only the history of brain tumor imaging, but it does tell the history of neuroradiology as a whole. And that was probably the most interesting thing to me. It was also very interesting to find those people who we regard as giants in neuroradiology and to see what they published many, many years ago and what led them to become such a big name in our subspecialty. And it was also very interesting to see the significant change that the different imaging modalities produce with relationship to brain imaging throughout the last 100 years. Obviously, as you said, it not only involved looking at articles in radiology, but many of them outside of radiology. And those were perhaps the highlights of this work that took me about 3 months. I don't know if you remember, but I told you that I decided to look at every single table of contents and then take out each article that I saw in the table of contents that were related to brain tumor imaging, and I read them. At the beginning, I did have a little bit of a problem trying to decide how I was going to handle it, perhaps looking at the articles that had had the most citations in the literature, and then I decided that I would just look at all of them because some, at least in my experience and my opinion, some very important articles at the time they published go relatively uncited in the literature. So that's why I decided to do a more of an all-encompassing view of the articles in radiology.
It sounds like a lot of work, and I think your experience with the citations we've all had, the older articles just didn't get cited as much. They were harder to find, for one thing. Everybody didn't have access to them like they do today. Well, we really wanted to highlight inflection points of technology to show how hardware and software have allowed for changes in diagnosis and management of patients. And I was wondering if you could just mention a few of these technology inflection points that you noticed in your review.
So Debbie, after completing my review, the way that I think about neuroradiology nowadays, it is divided into two large parts. Let's call them the first 50 or 60 years and the second 50 or 60 years. The first 50 years, more or less, were characterized by techniques that we don't use anymore except for angio. Most of the initial work was done using plain radiographs or radiographs of the skull. It is amazing that those physicians and radiologists at that time could do diagnosis so well with only plain films. And then later on came angio, and as you know, that was probably the mainstay of neuroimaging for about 50 years. And to a lesser degree, some kind of contrast study of the ventricular system or the subarachnoid space, whether it be done with a positive contrast or a negative contrast, such as air. And then I think that the major inflection point came in the early 70s with CT, which, as you know, finally allowed us to take a look at the lesions directly and not indirectly by the way that they produce shift on the ventricular system on shift or shift on the blood vessels. So CT was probably the biggest inflection point, if you want to call it, in neuroradiology. I have the impression, and I know that a lot of people will not like me saying this, but that neuroradiology was relatively stagnant till the early 70s. For before one or two decades before that, you know, neuroradiologists had been using those techniques that I've mentioned and really had made very little progress. You know, so now CT was a huge step forward. And you may recall that the first CTs were designed to image only the brain. The patient put its head in some bags full of water, and only the brain was imaged. And then a few years later, we had finally the whole body CT scanners. Then I think, obviously, the next big step came with MR, and opposite to CT, that just allowed us to see some anatomic intrinsic features of the lesion and its relationship to the adjacent structures. I think that MR did open the road for a lot of physiological imaging, particularly with the addition of new techniques in the last two decades. And particularly now, it is opening new horizons with the idea of radiogenomics, that is, that there are some distinct imaging features, at least on MR, that will help us identify the different genetic problems or issues with each of the brain tumors. But what is amazing, Debbie, is that in the last 100 years, from the beginning of plain films to now that we have such a sophisticated thing as MR, our problems with imaging of brain tumors have been very, very similar. The same problems that those guys were having 100 years ago, we're having them now. So that to me was a very, very interesting thing to find out. You know, the problems continue to be the same. And the main problem is, you know, how can we make a diagnosis early enough to save the life of a patient?
Wonderful, wonderful. You know, and you've touched on this just a little bit. You've talked about the past and more recently CT and the future with radiogenomics. What do you see also coming down with imaging research that might advance brain tumor imaging and neuroradiology in general?
Well, I think that things that will help us understand the genetic composition of brain tumors, things that will help us understand how chemotherapy and radiation therapy and perhaps genetic manipulation works. As you know, nowadays, we have the issues of pseudoprogression and pseudoregression, which are discussed in the article, which are the imaging effects of the therapy that we're giving to the patients. And that has caused a significant confusion as to what these findings mean to the patients. So I think that we need to move forward into more and more physiological imaging, more biochemical imaging, and more radiogenomics. Now, having said that, I still think that we're a while away from that. I think that the problem that we have with radiogenomics is that the number of sequences that we use to evaluate brain tumors is relatively small, and that there is a significant amount of overlap between the findings of one tumor that has one genetic composition and another tumor that has a different genetic composition. So I think that we're in the right direction. I see this as we're evolving into the next step beyond anatomical imaging and into a different type of imaging. Now, that is not to say that anatomical imaging is not great. It's been, you know, the cornerstone of radiology and neuroradiology for hundreds of years, or 100 years. And the majority of the diagnosis that we make in reality can be made with just the anatomical imaging. I think that you and I would be able to tell that it's a neoplasia in one or a different part of the body just by looking at anatomical images, but that is not anymore what radiologists ought to be doing. You know, to say the patient has a brain tumor really adds little value to the diagnosis and what we really can do with our imaging techniques. So moving to other things will be very interesting. And one thing that we need to remember is that all of the new techniques have found their first applications in neuroimaging. When you think about angiography, when you think about pneumoencephalography, when you think about ultrasound, remember ultrasound initially was used to measure midline displacement of the brain before it was used for many other things. CT, as I said, that's really important because that was designed to look at the brain. And then MR, you remember the beginning of MR too, for many, many years, 90 to 95% of all of our MR studies were brain and central nervous system studies. And then MR was found to be equally useful in other parts of the body, and musculoskeletal and abdomen and the heart and other things. So I think that we need to move beyond this idea of just anatomical imaging if we really want to add value to what we do as radiologists and neuroradiologists.
That is just wonderful. Well, Mauricio, it's been such a pleasure to talk with you today, and I just want to thank you. You wrote such a beautiful article, and you were the very first one to get it in on time, ahead of time, and it's just been a pleasure to work with you on this. So thank you so very much for your time.
No, thank you, Debbie, and I hope that the readers will learn as much as I did from the article. Many thanks for inviting me, and many thanks for having me doing this interview. Always great to talk to you.
Me too.